there, AMP2 students. Welcome to the second video on renal physiology. In this video, we will be continuing the discussion of urine formation by looking at reabsorption and secretion. Now, the entire renal tubule is involved in reabsorption. However, it is the proximal convoluted tubules that are the most active reabsorbers. So we will spend a bit of time here. Let's take a look at this very busy picture from your textbook, figure 24.5. We can see the different cells that make up the nephron. Up top, we have the cells of the two layers of the capsule, and then the different cells that make up the tubule. Let's take a look at the cells of the proximal convoluted tubule, and we'll see a cuboidal or columnar cell with a high number of microvilli. And if you recall from studying reabsorption in the small intestine, microvilli increase surface area. We also see an incredible abundance of mitochondria in the proximal convoluted tubule cells because of the activity of the sodium-potassium pump. Sodium is the most abundant cation in the filtrate, and there's a lot of energy needed to reabsorb it. We will look at the tubule cells in the other parts of the nephron later on in this video. For now, let's focus on the proximal convoluted tubule. I have used figure 24.14 from your textbook as inspiration for my animation. Make sure you can draw out the process of reabsorption that I will be showing you here. As I continue to draw at a very high rate of speed, I will label the important elements of this figure. You may want to pause the video here and review from Chapter 3 the membrane transport proteins that you learned about in AMP1, specifically the carrier and channel proteins, and also review active transport, secondary active transport, and facilitated diffusion. As I label the different elements of the proximal convoluted tubule and peritubular capillaries, keep in mind that the peritubular capillaries, which branch off of the efferent arteriole, are now a low hydrostatic pressure and high colloid osmotic pressure system. Anything that makes it into the interstitial space will get reabsorbed back into the bloodstream. Water and solutes can take one of two routes of reabsorption. Proximal convoluted tubule cells are not as tightly joined as other tubular cells, so some substances will take the route in between the cells. Most substances, however, will move through the cells. We will first focus on sodium because it is the most abundant cation in the filtrate. At the basolateral membrane of this PCT cell, I'm drawing in a transport carrier that's going to transport 3 sodium out of the cell and 2 potassium into the cell. And you may have guessed it, this is the sodium-potassium pump. And it's always working to increase the concentration of sodium in the interstitial space. This is very important. This sets up a huge concentration gradient for sodium, which plays an important role in reabsorption. There's a big energy expenditure for this process, but it assures the reabsorption of vital nutrients, vitamins, and ions to occur. If we look to the apical membrane, we see the same type of sodium co-transporter that we saw in the digestive system. This is a secondary active transport system that rides on the back of the huge concentration gradient that sodium has. And the movement of sodium into the cell along its concentration gradient drives these carrier proteins. In our example, we see the co-transport of glucose. Now, water is driven out of the tubules and into the peritubular capillaries by a strong osmotic gradient. A special channel protein specific for water called the aquaporin allows the relatively unopposed movement of water through the cell. The body is obliged to reabsorb water through the process because these aquaporins make the proximal convoluted tubule highly permeable to water. This is called obligatory water reabsorption. This is not the case in other areas of the tubule, and we will revisit the aquaporin when we get to the collecting duct. In a healthy kidney, all glucose and amino acids are reabsorbed in the proximal convoluted tubule. This is especially important in relationship to glucose. In a healthy individual, glucose levels in the blood range between 70 and 100 milligrams per deciliter. At this concentration, there are plenty of glucose transporters in the apical membranes of the proximal convoluted tubule. In situations where blood glucose concentrations rise, there's a critical level at about 180 milligrams per deciliter at which point the glucose transporters begin to get saturated and cannot work fast enough to transport all of the glucose from the filtrate back into the bloodstream. At this point, glucose will begin to spill into the urine. Let's take a look at an animation showing glucose reabsorption, where at first the transporters are able to keep up with the glucose molecules, but as concentration levels rise, the transporters get saturated and there's a backlog so that some glucose escapes reabsorption. My animation is far from realistic in that there are hundreds of transporters in each cell and certainly more than one cell functioning to reabsorb these nutrients. But I think you get the picture. Now this situation brings to mind a famous scene from a very famous show called I Love Lucy. Enjoy this classic. Ah, truly a classic. So in a healthy individual, 65% of water and sodium will be reabsorbed at the proximal convoluted tubule, and all of the nutrients and vitamins and most of the ions as well. Let's move on down the tubule to talk a little bit more about reabsorption. At the nephron loop, water and solutes will move independently of one another. This is different than in the proximal convoluted tubule. Here, water leaves the descending limb of the loop, but not the ascending limb. This is due to a lack of aquaporins in the ascending limb. Solutes, on the other hand, readily leave the ascending limb, but not the descending limb. We will look further at this phenomenon when we look at the mechanisms behind the kidney's ability to form concentrated urine for the conservation of water. Reabsorption in the distal convoluted tubule and the collecting duct is finely controlled by hormones, and we will be investigating it further in our next video. We'll be studying two hormones that control these tubules, antidiuretic hormone produced by the posterior pituitary, and aldosterone, which is produced by the adrenal gland. The third step in the process of urine formation is tubular secretion. Tubular secretion will remove any unwanted substances from the bloodstream that did not make it into the filtrate, or was reabsorbed but is not needed by the body. Such things as lipid-soluble medications, metabolic waste products, or toxins. Now, urea is secreted as well as reabsorbed in a sort of cyclic loop. And the tubular cells will also secrete substances that help to fine-tune acid-base and electrolyte balance. So that's it for this video and the formation of urine. I've highlighted the most important information that you need to know. In the last video of this chapter, we'll be looking at how the body makes its final adjustments on urine for a dilute or a concentrated product. And I'll see you next time.